Dragons, welcome to Peyton Place. So it's been a week since Rise of Skywalker has come out. I have seen it twice. Also just mainly because I felt like I missed a lot because this movie is long and I feel like it's a lot jammed into a short period of time. In case you do not know, these are spoilers. So if you have not seen it this past week, then don't watch. If you don't care about spoilers, then stay. So all in all, let me just start off with saying I liked this. And seeing it a second time, I actually liked it more. So originally I gave it like a C minus. I actually gave it like maybe like a C+, B-. That I would buy this. I would watch it again. Does it have issues? Oh yeah. But does that detract from the fact that I actually enjoyed myself and I felt like I could watch this again? No. I felt that there was enough good that it made me want to keep watching and go watch it a second time. I would even see it again in theaters. So before anybody wants to try to be disrespectful in comments, please don't do that. We all can agree to disagree. If you did not like this film, you can just say, you know, glad you liked it. I thought it was bad, but agree to disagree. There's no need for name calling. And there's a saying in this that all you want is for me to hate, but I won't. And I'm sorry, it's not gonna be me. I will say what's wrong with it though. I will say that, again, there's a lot of issues with this and there's a lot of that's wrong with it, and they relied heavily on nostalgia to get them through it. And maybe that's why I enjoyed a lot of it. I will admit I was never a fan of the whole Reylo thing. I didn't like it in 7. I barely remember 8, so who knows what even happened in 8 at this point. I only saw it once. But for episode 9, I had myself at the end of it that I liked them together because it kind of was that Anakin Padme thing that she saw good in Kylo. She saw the Ben, obviously, and that's who she, like, wanted to, you know, if I was going to join with you, I'd want to join with Ben. But so, okay, let's just get into this. Sorry, I'm kind of rambling because there's a lot, and I wrote notes that all of these notes are from 2 viewings of it. Like, it's just, and a lot of it was hard for me to read and took me forever to write it all out. So if I look to the right, it's because I'm looking at my notes that I wrote down and it took me forever to decipher what I wrote. It looked like I gave a pen to a chicken and wrote in my notebook. But let's get into this. I will say what was sad, my very first showing that I went to, no one clapped at all for the Lucasfilm, for the A Long Time Ago and A Galaxy Far, Far Away, Star Wars, nothing. For every other Star Wars showing I've been to in my life, everyone's always clapped at Lucasfilm, at A Long Time Ago and Galaxy Far Away, Star Wars, The Crawl, everything. This is the first time that did not happen. I think it's because we're all a little bit bitter still from episode 8. Even the second one, there was like light scattered applause, but not like the what? Start. Yeah, it was kind of sad. And I, with the opening crawl, like I'm really gonna go from A to Z here, y'all. With the opening crawl, like I felt like this was a book that I was reading, but all of a sudden this chapter, I was like, did any of this happen? I don't remember reading any of this. Like I felt I was reading from a chapter of a different book, even though it's the same book I'm in. Like What battle? I'm not trying to nitpick here, but I'm just going from like my notes and what I wrote. I don't know, the crawl, I was just like, no. And then the Sith Pathfinder, Sith Wayfinder, like I legit felt like this was, you know, like Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. This felt like Kylo Ren and the Sith Wayfinder. Like you couldn't come up with a better name, just Sith Wayfinder. Like, that's why I felt this kind of, like, had a hint of in this movie, that they're trying to find this, like, stone, but trying to find this Sith way, just, it was weird. All right, getting into where we see that, okay, we're on Exegol, which also in the movie, I was like, Dexegol? Exegol? What the fuck are you saying? I feel like I need subtitles here with this. But for Exegol, that, also, A, why has this never been mentioned? So, I guess it's the hidden, no one knows about it except for the Sith, but you would think that maybe Palpatine could have mentioned it once to Anakin? I don't know. But you have this place with all these crazy statues of these Sith lords, and a Jurassic Park episode 3 of Snoke's body parts and heads that, like, in episode 3 of Jurassic Park, that all the little baby dinosaurs are in these, like, these tank incubator things, and then you have that version of Snoke. Like, that's what it reminded me of. I was like, all right, so Palpatine's like, I created Snoke and I was the voice inside your head this whole entire time, and the James Earl Jones voice coming back, that was awesome. But I'm just like, so it's always been Palpatine. So they had mentioned in the opening crawl the Phantom Emperor, so made me think, okay, from episode 1, the Phantom Menace, I know people, like, so it made me think, this whole entire series, yeah, it's a Skywalker saga, but is it all also with just Palpatine always? that he's been running the show from the very beginning. It's been him all along with his final order that's coming and blah, blah, blah. That the Phantom Menace, like, so, like, and he's the Phantom Emperor, so it starts with the Phantom, ends with the Phantom. Like, I think, I feel like, I don't know, maybe it's just me and I'm just putting that together myself, but, like, that's what I took away from that, was, like, it's been him from the beginning to the end. And I feel like, I will say with this movie a lot, JJ recycles a lot. I'm all about, you know, recycling and, you know, conservation, but he recycled a lot in this, like, with the dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider unnatural. Is that, like, Palpatine's way of, like, if I say this, I know I'll hook them, because then it's like, well, what kind of powers? What kind of, like, that's, like, Kylo's thing of, like, well, what could you do for me? And then he says, like, so it's like, is that just, like, your gimmick, like, you're a salesman, and that's how you sell the dark side, by saying that it's a pathway to the Force that many abilities some consider unnatural? Like, and I feel like, yeah, a lot of this stuff, you guys, a lot of this is fan service, a lot of this is nostalgia, a lot of this is to get us loving, like, oh my god, this was from this, oh my god. So it kind of just felt like a compilation of all the movies and all the parts of the movies we loved all in one. So maybe that's why I enjoyed it. Because, like, I'm not gonna lie, I mouthed along to when he said that, I was like, ah, I love that quote. But was that the purpose of it? Probably. That whole interaction when you first see Palpatine with Kylo and just the flashes on his face and the creepiness and, like, the fact that he's, like, basically looks like he's blind with, like, everything. It just creepy so well. That was really well done. I love that. It just, Palpatine at his finest and at his creepiest. And the whole, like, she's not who you think she is. Well, who is she? And then do what Vader couldn't. Vader did a lot. So don't undercut Vader and say he didn't do ish. He's the one that really started this whole Empire thing for you, of being your biggest henchman, essentially. Sorry, Vader, love you. But don't undercut what he did, you dick. Then we get into Chewie playing Djarik, and, you know, again, another recycling, but you still love it that, and I'll say that's the only interaction of Poe and Finn that I like together. I feel like they tried way too hard this whole entire trilogy to make Finn and Poe, like, that kind of maybe Han and Luke banter-ish, like, It wasn't happening. Poe's not Han Solo. And I'm gonna admit, guys, I could care less about Poe. I could care less about Finn. About Rey. This movie made me like her a little bit more, and I liked Kylo Ren more in this movie than I have and cared about the whole entire trilogy. So, like, that's the thing. I've grown from episode 8, which I started 2 years ago, to now. I've grown, and that's when I talk about, like, you know, we all need to be more kind of respectful when we talk to each other about things we disagree on. And that's the thing, like, I did not like Rey at all. I did not like Kylo at all. But now I'm like, yeah, you're not so bad. So it's like, that's the thing, like, maybe over time, who knows, maybe in 20 years I'll watch The Last Jedi again. Who knows? My whole point was just that I love seeing Chewie playing that again. Then, like, he's cheating. Oh, yeah, there's no way he's cheating. Well, it's like, of course he's good. He's 250 years old. He's had a lot of practice. So, like, that was the only interaction banter I liked between Poe and Finn. Everything else just felt forced, and I didn't feel, like, a connection with them. I know they want to say, like, they're, like, bros, but I don't care. And I've never cared about their characters. Like, no disrespect, just don't care. And also, this orange goo of an alien, Claude, reminds me of Monsters, Inc. Like, I feel like he's a mix of characters. What was the purpose of Claude, unless you're just trying to sell Claude as a toy for a marketing thing? But Claude was so pointless, and I was just like, this, you're taking Star Wars and kind of, like, turning it more into a money grab of what can we possibly push out to be, like, something kids could buy. I'm not gonna lie to you, Claude was stupid. Wasn't into it. That's just me. And then this whole, like, light speed skipping is like Guardians of the Galaxy 2. When they're doing the jumps and, like, you can only do 50 at a time, and they did 700. Like, that's, like, the popping in and out of, you know, planets and their fate. Like, that's what I felt with the light speed skipping was, where they're just popping in and out of things. So you can see all these different planets and stuff, which, yeah, I understand it can be cool because we want to see more of the galaxy and all that. But it just, I felt like, yeah, a lot of this was unfortunately recycled. That I'm like, I've seen this. And then you flash to Rey sitting Indian style saying, be with me. That just looked horrible. It looks so fake. And then when she comes down, it's like, you can see and tell that she is on a wire and flipping down from the wire. Like, that could not have been slower and more like, I am wearing a wire and this isn't, like, because I feel like, at least with the prequels even too, that everybody moved well. Like, everybody moved, like, it flowed. And, like, when Anakin and Obi-Wan jumped and everything, again, no disrespect, me personally did not like the whole Leia story in this. It obviously, rest in peace, you beautiful princess, that this is after Carrie's death and they're using what they had for episode 8. So, you know, I'll give Rian Johnson that we have something to kind of take off of. But her storyline just felt like we need to send her out some way. So, like, let's just throw all this and kind of patch it and maybe make it make sense and fit. Like, it felt like a puzzle that, you know, she isn't belongs in this puzzle, but the piece you're trying to put in here, it's close, but it's not the right piece. It's not gonna fit no matter how many times you try to do it, and you can't just like cut around it to force it. Like, it has to fit naturally, and I don't feel like it fit naturally in the story. And plus, like, the whole, like, how in the hell can Leia train Rey, and that they had to throw back in that scene of like their back, like, way flashback, where the CGI Luke looked way better than the CGI Leia of them, like, that Luke was training her, and that explains why she could have done the Mary Poppins Superman thing in episode 8, and now it's maybe, okay, then that's how she can train Rey, that she was trained by Luke, okay, fine, but it's sad that you need to do that, because we're all like, how and where did you get all this? Yes, everyone has, I mean, yes, she has feelings, and she is force sensitive, but she's never trained in it, so I'm like, how all of a sudden can you be a master and train, but okay, fine, now you showed us she's trained by Luke. Okay, but I don't know. And yeah, the nostalgia of also that, like, that combat remote that Luke had in episode 4, that was cool. And BB-8 forever will always be super cute. Never say anything bad about BB-8. So, like, love him the whole entire thing. You love the nostalgia of Admiral Akbar's son, Junior. Like, that, like, I love seeing stuff like that. I love the throwbacks, and, like, yeah, that's what holds me on to episode 9 more, I think, is all of this nostalgia and throwbacks. But overall, I like the story. Don't really like how it ended, but it's like, it got me, you know? And so then it makes you think that, do you need to be watching The Mandalorian when you watch Star Wars Episode 9? Because they talked about dark science cloning, and that only the Sith know how to do that. So it makes you wonder then, did Palpatine, since Palpatine was alive during this Mandalorian time, and that we saw, spoilers again, see The Mandalorian, Baby Yoda has the healing powers that we see Rey has when she, like, heals the serpent. So if Palpatine, because it was 5 years after the Empire was ended, so episode 6, Palpatine's still alive, we all now know that. So did Palpatine create dark side cloning? Did he create Baby Yoda? And that's why they're trying to get him, like, the Empire loyalists are trying to get him back, because he was created, and that Yoda was never taught the good or bad, so he has both, like, abilities to, you know, force choke and all this stuff, but also do good and heal. So it's, like, very interesting. I feel like, yeah, like, I love that now thinking about The Mandalorian kind of ties into this and kind of, like, oh, if you watch it, you're like, oh my god, because Baby Yoda can do that and Rey can do it. Okay, like, that's cool. You just love throughout the whole entire thing all the classic OT music, like the Imperial March and everything just overplaying, and, you know, you gotta love John Williams. You can never say anything bad about his music. And I love that he was in this too. Like, the first showing, I was like, who is this guy? And everyone's like, it's John Williams. And watching the second time, I'm like, oh my god, it is. And he was a bartender. So now that's, because also since I'm a bartender, I'm like, all right, I'm a good company. That's cool. That's fine. Speaking of, like, with nostalgia, sorry if I kind of seem all over the place. I'm kind of trying to go in order of the movie, of just, like, the thoughts I had and things I noticed. That, again, with recycling, that when Kylo Ren is talking to all the First Order at the table, and there's that one guy that has to speak out, like in episode 4, when Vader force choked him, he's like, Vader, release him, as you wish. He did that again with the force choke, but threw him, like, up against the ceiling, so it's a little bit different, but it still had that feel of Vader and Kylo. Is very, like, it paralleled, so, like, I know you changed some things up here and there, but come on, it's, like, the same thing. And also for everybody that's, like, given 3PO crap, I love 3PO in this. Every time, even the second showing, I was still laughing at all the quips he said, like, you didn't say my name, sir, but I'm all right. And then, like, good job, sir. Terrible job, sir. And the, like, when he goes back to his, OG sayings, like, this is madness, because when he gets his brain wiped, like, I love seeing 3PO through all this. And, like, even the scene when they get on that planet and they're having that, like, festival, which happens every 42 years, ha-ha, that's how long Star Wars has been out. Great tie and great little, like, nod there. That he's like, oh, they're known for the delectable, like, sweets. And everyone's, like, looking at him. He just, what? Like, what are you guys looking at? I love 3PO in this. I loved him in this. I was cracking up every time. So, like, agree or disagree, I liked him. I love that there's always that one thing that's in every movie. And I love the I've got a bad feeling about this. I love that it was Lando. It was the one that delivered that, like, that final I've got a bad feeling about this. I felt it was great to kind of, like, an OG OT character is delivering that line in the last movie. I love that. I thought that was great. I love Lando in this. I feel like that you can truly see the Billy Dee Williams. I feel like you should really see that he loves being back in this and that he was just so happy and so just, you felt like you're just watching Lando. And I love that. Like, it made me tear up because I was just, you can feel his happiness and feel his excitement. So, okay, when we're on this, like, festival, on this planet where they're having this festival, and they steal the speeders, which kind of feels like also like a pod race when they're going in between the canyons. I was like, this feels very much like a pod race. Again, recycling. Those stormtroopers' aim has improved over the years, I must say. The fact that they were able to blast both those speeders and they flip out, which also, how did they not die from that? Like, I know you want to see the land in the quicksand, but still, like, pretty sure you would die. But, you know, props to stormtroopers for someone improving their aim over the last 42 years. And I just, like, felt like throughout the movie, there were, like, maybe a lot of, like, small hidden messages of that Snap was being so kind of like, oh, God. And then Princess Leia is just, like, you know, keep being a little bit more optimistic. He's like, this is fantastic. You have no idea how great this is going to turn out. Like, he's being sarcastic, but I feel like, was that JJ trying to say that to us? Like, this is going to, like, you have no idea how this is going to turn, good how this is going to turn out. Like, I don't know. Like, I felt like those were, like, little things, like, for us. Like, yeah, everyone needs to try to be more optimistic here and not, like, I'm not seeing, like, I didn't walk into this, like, saying no matter what, I'm going to try to, like, hate this or I'm going to try to like this. I walked in open-minded and I left liking it. Like, if it sucked, you guys, I personally would have said it sucked. Like I obviously did with The Last Jedi, and just like I obviously did with Game of Thrones Season 8. If it was a dumpster fire, I would have said it was a dumpster fire. It's not like that phrase, actually. If it wasn't my cup of tea, I would have said it wasn't my cup of tea. Whether you read the spoilers or not, which I admit I read spoilers before I watched this, I was hoping they wouldn't be true, because sometimes I read spoilers and they're not true. But with Rey being a Palpatine, that when she and Kylo are pulling that, like, transport, which I was like, this is a little much, and then she blasts the lightning, like, I feel like you just instantly knew, okay, lightning coming out of her fingers, you know that's a Palpatine. Like, it kind of, because that's the thing, the feeling in the theater when, like, Kylo tells her that she's a Palpatine, no one seems surprised by that. Everyone's just, you're Palpatine. Okay. Didn't feel like any shock, no, like, oh my God, it felt just so lackluster. And that's the thing, her being a Palpatine just kind of makes no sense. I don't like it. I would have preferred a Kenobi. It just literally was like, here's a storyline and this is where you got the Palpatine idea, like, out of left field. And I liked when they go into that cantina to, like, with John Williams, they kind of find Babu Frick, who I'm just calling Baba Ganoush because I keep forgetting his name. But I like that all the different creatures, because that's how a cantina should be. If you're going to say that there is a cantina somewhere or Star Wars related, it should maybe be more on that lines, but whatever, I'm gonna digress. I will say, like, I didn't like it in the 8th one. For what I remember of episode 8, I didn't like it. But this one, I don't know what it was, but this whole, like, force bond, they're a dyad in the force, and they're so strong, and, you know, that there's only, like, they've never seen that in generations, blah, blah, blah. The force bond between Kylo and Rey, the fact that they can see each other, but not see each other's surroundings, but they can see each other, interact with each other, he can take the necklace from her, they can cross blades and all that, like, when they're on Kijimi, that I actually like that. It was different, and it, like, I like that kind of, like, concept, like, that they are so connected that they can see each other, which I remember we saw in 8, like, he was shirtless or something. Yeah, right? That was episode 8. See, I barely remember episode 8. It was so long ago. But I like this force bond thing that they have together. Like, it's different. It made for very interesting fights. So I was like, all right, Hux being the spy. My biggest eye roll was Rey's jump off of Kylo's destroyer to get onto the Falcon, like, onto the ramp. It was just the fakest. It was just bad. I didn't like the flip that she did when she was on that one planet where she, like, flips over his fighter and, like, with her lightsaber. But seeing it, I didn't like it in the trailer, but seeing the movie, I liked it. Maybe just because we see that she cut off the wing of it, and that seemed better, and, like, that flowed better. Okay, one of my favorite moments in this was the destroyed Death Star. The chills you get seeing it and the music behind it that they threw the OT and, like, the music of the Imperial March. Just wow. And just to think of, like, you seeing these, like, it's kind of like if you got to, like, walk in your, like, idol's footsteps. Like, if I got to walk where, like, when I go to London, going to Freddie Mercury's house, like, just being outside, like, that wall, it's just chills. And, like, just something I feel like we all have, that one person, like, if we can stand where they once stood. So being that mindset for Rey, like, even though she may not maybe appreciate it as much, who knows, but like as I would, like if was in that universe and I was like on the actual original Death Star that was in pieces, you see these older trooper helmets and their stuff, the old TIE fighters, and you just see everything, and then seeing like Palpatine's throne and the window where Luke looked out of, and he tried to get Luke to come to the dark side. It just chills throughout my body. I was like, oh my God, this is genius. Just so unbelievably cool. And I know I hated her dark side saber before because it seemed like a compact Darth Maul saber. Seeing it, it makes more sense for her because she's used to a staff, which I am better, I think, with at times also a double-bladed saber. I feel like I'm good with single hilt, but it made more sense for her because that's what she's used to. But I didn't like the hiss with like this, like the really skinny teeth, like a vampire. Like her teeth aren't gonna automatically change because she becomes a Sith Lord. Like that. I felt like it was like an Indiana Jones grab when she was grabbing the Sith Finder. Like, okay, grab. And then when she does it, like her dark side self appears. And their fight on the Death Star, really, like I said it before, reminded me of like such reminiscence of Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, where Anakin and Obi-Wan are fighting on Mustafar, and instead of hot lava, you've got cold water. And when that, there was that piece of the, on Mustafar, where they were like, it was kind of like this long thing that had like, it looked like this at the end, that Obi-Wan jumped off of and got on the ground. He was like watching Anakin. Anakin like swung back onto it, and then he had to run off and jump off and land on that one little dude that was carrying the like cube of lava. That's what it felt like, that when Rey like jumped over and was like waiting, Kylo just walked through the midst of it. It just felt like that. While their lightsaber battle together is better, it's still not Anakin versus Obi-Wan. I did like it better than their other fights that they've had. So I will say that. And that also, again, with the whole Leia thing, this is the way she went out, by using all of her strength to reach Ben so he would stop and not kill Rey. And then Rey stabs him, which basically in a way killing Kylo Ren. And then she heals him in the part where she was like, I did want to take your hand. Ben's hand made me tear up. And like you see when she healed him that his scar was also gone. I noticed that when he came back to save her at the end. Like I didn't know if I remember it now, like when she did it. But when she healed like him, like she felt like she completely healed him, and he's now Ben. It sucks because like he said, you can't go back, just like I can't. And it sucks like now that Leia passed, that he never got to see his mother again. That hurt for me, for him. And even though he had the memory thing of speaking with Han, and that, again, recycling the same conversation that he had in episode 7, like, I know what I'd have to do, but I don't know if I have the strength to do it. And he's just like, I'll help, or like, I'll, you can. And so instead of killing his dad, he should have chucked the saber like he should have in episode 7, but he didn't. And so he kind of had that redemption. So I felt bad because now he's like, yeah, he's all alone. Like his parents are gone. He doesn't have anybody anymore. So like it is kind of sad. And he realizes that, you know, like, what have I done? Unfortunately, way too late. But it's kind of like, hey, Anakin, yeah, he killed all the younglings, but he realized the horrible stuff he's done. So he saved his son, kind of like redeemed himself in a way. And so I feel like that's what he's doing. With Rey towards Kylo Ben, it felt kind of like Padme towards Anakin. Like, there's still good in him. I know there is. And that's why she saved him. So then we get into the fact that we discover that the Final Order, every Star Destroyer has planet-killing abilities. It's like when you're in like middle school and you have these really cool, unique shoes and you think you're all cool, then the next week everyone has them. It's not as cool anymore. It loses its effect. So you're making the Death Star and the Starkiller base seem redundant. Like, they're not as cool anymore. I understand it's intimidating that everything can kill every planet, but it just loses its cool factor. Like, that's what the Death Star was. Like, I didn't like that either. I just felt like you're downplaying what the Death Star was. I get the point, but I didn't like it. And yeah, I know everyone's saying it's kind of like a big middle finger to Rian Johnson, that when Rey went to go chuck her lightsaber into the fire and Luke grabs it. And again, no one clapped when they saw Luke in either of the showings. Usually people do when we see our OG characters, but no one did. So I thought that was also very telling and kind of sad. But he's like, what do you do? I was like, a Jedi's weapon deserves more respect. What are you doing? Kind of like, I felt like, was that to Rian Johnson? Like, you should not have done that in episode 8, that Luke would never just chuck his, like, calm. Then Luke lifting the X-Wing out of the water, also very recycled, very much like so when Yoda did that with Dagobah, and the same music that was playing when he did it. So props to Luke that he finally raised his X-Wing out of water. Maybe dead when he did it, but at least he got to do it. And then there was another line that came up that said, good people will fight if we lead them. And it kind of goes into Star Wars right now, that more of us need to, if we liked it, we need to voice it more that we liked it, because I don't want Star Wars to be killed. I don't want Star Wars to be dead. And I don't want all the hate to win, and that people are just hating this movie just because they want to hate it and because it's popular and it's for no reason. That I understand, like, there's faults with it for sure. If you don't like it, you don't like it, and I respect that. But when it comes to people are going off on each other and like saying you're stupid and you're dumb for liking it, or like you make no sense, you're an idiot, all the things that people have said to each other, that no, like, we need to be able to say it's okay to like this, and don't be afraid to voice it just because you're afraid of the people, or not even afraid, but you just don't want the people going off on you. Like, I liked it, and I'm not afraid to say I liked it. And again, people can agree and disagree. Another scene I just really could not with was when Poe is giving his speech, and it's like a voiceover, and you see what everyone's doing, everyone's loading things up. If you have ever seen Bring It On, this is what it reminded me of. Like, where they're talking about that they have to work classes and overnight, and you have Torrance's voice playing, everyone's like clapping in the hallways and they're practicing. And they're just like, we have to trust our instincts, all of our instincts. Like, that's what it felt like. This voiceover, it just felt like I was watching a Star Wars version of Bring It On. That seemed too movie-like and not, I'm in the Star Wars universe. Like, you felt, the other movies, I feel like I'm in them, not like truly watching a movie. It just like took me out of it, and I did not like it. Then you see all the Sith chanting in this like giant stadium, which I'm like, you guys sound like you're speaking Parseltongue from like Harry Potter. Like, I can't even understand you. I'm like, what? You're telling me all these Sith are just all chilling and just hanging around, like waiting for like the day to come? Like, I don't get it. That like that also just came out of nowhere that there's that many Sith. Like, that was a lot. Unless you're saying those are Sith followers. I don't know, but like that just seemed like so much. But then again, I know it's been years and years and years and years. I get that. And they look like Dementors. Or, you know, Death Eaters that were just, like, sitting, like, following Voldemort and then now following Palpatine. But then I was like, yeah, Palpatine's interaction with Rey, like, kind of gave me chills in the way that he's like, I never wanted you dead. I wanted you here, Empress. Like, when he said Empress, I don't know why. Like, I was like, ooh, creepy to think about. Like, I didn't catch it in the first viewing, but I caught it in the second when they kind of do this, like, freeze shot of the original X-Wing and then the original TIE Fighter. And I love that. Like, that is what iPhone backgrounds, computer background screens are made of. Like, that was such, like, an oh my god shot moment. Loved that. When Kylo is now Ben, I felt myself like him more when he jumped onto the statue and was like, ow, like, that was funny. And then him coming to save her, I just loved it. I like the whole when she's like, okay, like when she like she sees him and that connects with him that he's there, and she does the whole lightsaber behind her and like drops it. She has the other one. That was all. And his like his little thing he did when he was just like when he showed his like the blue one and with the Knights of Ren, he's just, well, I guess this is what I'm doing now. So, okay, like what do you want from me? Like I had this cool lightsaber and now I got this one. Like, I don't know why, like, I thought that was so funny, and I loved it. I was like, that is hilarious. But, man, he got his ass kicked, and I'm like, dude! Oh, man. And then this saber battle between her in front of Palpatine and then him with the Knights of Ren, like, that was way more fluid. Like, it got better in this episode, I felt like. I felt like it was far better than what they had been, and that I appreciated and liked. It will never be on par with Anakin versus Obi-Wan, but it was much better. And then when you finally see, when all those ships appear, when those hundreds of thousands of ships or whatever disappeared, like, gorgeous sight to see. And that, the whole thing of when they said they win by making you think you're alone, like, there's more of us. Like, that's the thing. Like, it also goes back to this, of that, the haters and the people who just want to hate and the bullies win by making us think that those of us that like this movie and still like the franchise and love the franchise are alone. Like, the more of us that speak up and say we like it, then maybe more will. And, like, the hatred will die and then the positivity and those who liked it will rise. Not that saying, again, that you can't not like this film. You're allowed to not like it. It's like, I'm allowed to like it. But that's how hatred wins, is by making people who think they like it think that they're a minority and that it's small. So that's why I'm not afraid to say I like it, because I did. And then Wedge and Tilly's being the gunner for Lando, amazing. I love that together too. But also again, recycling, showing like when, you know, stand together, die together, and Rey looking up and seeing like your friends, like fate, they'll die if you don't join me. Like, very reminiscent also of episode 6 when Emperor Palpatine was showing Luke and like, your friends are gonna, like, again, your friends are gonna die if you don't join me, blah, blah, blah. Very reminiscent of that, but lost it. Lost my damn mind when I heard all the voices. I'm getting chills now just thinking about it. Oh my God, I'm about to cry too. Hearing Obi-Wan's voice, you and Aunt Alex, hearing Yoda and Anakin and just everybody. And then also which made me sad, because kind of like Emperor Palpatine, he's thrown off and dies, but he's been alive this whole entire time. So like when we saw Mace Windu thrown out the window, kind of like soap operas, no body, no, you're not dead. But hearing Mace's voice, I was like, oh man, damn, you are really dead. Like, but hearing all those, and it was hard to hear everybody's, even the second time around, but it makes you, and like Qui-Gon's voice too, just gives you chills and like gives you like all like the nostalgia happiness feels of like, oh my god, everybody. Would I have loved to see like maybe the Force ghosts of them appearing when they said something? Yeah, maybe a little bit, that probably might have been too much, but hearing their voices was, I loved, it was amazing. Amazing. Although when he said, I am all the Sith, and she's like, I am all the Jedi, yeah, very much, I am Iron Man. Like, did feel very much like that. I agree with people who said that. That's very, very true. I want all their voices, what everything that they said, as a ringtone. Like, that was so beautifully done as well. I just love that. Okay, that's the thing, like, I don't get. So that, yeah, he's like, I've fallen and so will the last Skywalker, and throws Kylo off, even though he ain't really dead. Does the whole arm on the cliff pulling himself up, because Rey died. So that's what I don't understand. So she died. So she didn't force ghost fade away. I don't get it. Is it because like they are so bonded that maybe she can't die until if they both have, but no, but she was dead. And so he had a little bit of life left. And so he gave the rest of his force life energy back to her. So like, that's why I don't understand. Like, she was supposed to be dead. He had a little bit of force life energy left. He goes up to her and like, he's like, that moment, that whole moment, that whole scene with them two is just, I liked it. I was crying. I felt so bad. I was like, god damn. And I was like, all right, I get the Reylo thing now. At that moment I did. The rest of the series did not. When he transferred that to her and then he instantly dies and force ghost fades away. Like, I didn't get that. How come she didn't instantly force ghost fade away, but he did? And also, why couldn't he just give a little bit to her and they both could have been alive and he could have, like, you know, lived his life then doing better things? Like, why is it that when people get redeemed, they die? Like, why couldn't he live? And also, if he's gonna be a force ghost, why couldn't he appear next to his mother at the end when she's burying their lightsabers? Why couldn't he appear next to Leia and Luke? Like, that's the thing. I read a spoiler saying that happened, but then it didn't. So unless it's gonna be in the DVD when it comes out, that better be. Because, like, that kind of seemed like that's not, because he's still a Skywalker. So why wasn't he force ghost with them? Kind of hate that. That made me sad. Like, why did he have to die? Unless they put it in the DVD that they're gonna show the Force Ghost him, like they did with Hayden Christensen when they replaced Sebastian Shaw at the end of 6, which a lot of people hated. I like, because like that was back when he was like a Jedi, is like, and not a Sith Lord, whatever. I liked it. Don't at me. Agree, disagree. But yeah, I really wanted Kylo to be next to them. And I maybe would have liked her to say maybe Rey Solo, because that's technically Ben's last name. And because, like, you know, she'll always be with them. And, like, see, when he transfers force energy to her, is it like, yeah, he's always going to be with her? Like, I don't know. Didn't want him to die. And the guy in front of me in the second showing was just, it's kind of funny to watch a dude do that. Like, wait, what? And then I thought it very recycled. Like I said, also in episode 6, when they, like, defeated the Empire and they showed all the different planets. And, like, when in the newer one, when they released it, like, they show Coruscant or Jar Jar's, like, and everyone's like, we're free! Like, they show all those planets. It's very interesting that they showed Cloud City, Endor, and Jakku. Why those three? Because those are just ones we'd recognize? I don't know. And then Chewie getting his medal that he damn well deserved at the end of episode 4. I know people want to say, like, Wookiees don't really believe in that, maybe, or something like that. But he deserved that medal. So the fact he finally got that, fan service. But you're correcting a mistake that was made 42 years ago. So love that. That was amazing. That was probably one of my favorite parts. And also, okay, when she does go back to Tatooine and does bury the sabers back at Luke's original house, like, I would have liked also, too, to hear voices of, like, Luke. Or it would have been cool to hear maybe, or hear Aunt Owen's and Aunt Beru's, like, voices. And I think it would have been nice to, like, maybe hear that a little bit. And I get why she buried them, because, like, she's putting them to rest and that, you know, she has her own. Which, did she make out of her staff? Because it looked like part of her staff that she originally had. And I like the whole, like, kind of wheel turning on instead of the button. That was cool. That I liked. Or, like, the push-up. I like that. I liked her saber. It fit her. And then it also just, like, ending on the twin sons with the music. That's how you started it. That's how you end it. I like that. And it makes you wonder, like, with Lando and this girl, Janna, where he's like, where are you from? And she's like, I don't know. It's like, well, maybe, like, we should find out. Are we getting, like, a Calrissian movie? Are we getting a Lando spinoff? I'd be here for that. To show he had, like, a daughter. Is that his daughter? Or who knows? I don't know. And also everyone's like wondering like what was Finn gonna tell Rey? Like I kind of want to know. At first it makes you wonder if he's gonna say I love you, but then it seems too obvious that maybe he's gonna say I am force sensitive. Like Rey, I have feelings, which I might be the only one, or maybe there's others. Again, agree or disagree. But I really don't like Finn being force sensitive. Like Finn being like feelings. I know there's some people that will always like can have those small connections to the force. I know a lot of people say that maybe Han Solo did, because that's why he's such a good pilot, and that's why he's able to talk himself out of all situations and all that. I just didn't really... It could just be you're just very skilled. Like, why is that to be you're automatically connected to the Force? Like, so saying if you're not connected to the Force, you have no power, you can't be a really good pilot? Like, I don't know. I just didn't like Finn being that Force-sensitive and feeling like when Rey died. I don't know. So maybe that's what he's going to tell her. Like, Rey, I also have a connection to the Force. Like, I don't know. I don't like that we didn't get an answer to that. There are no post-credit scenes, because obviously not going to be another one. But I don't know. That's the thing though. Overall, since the 2 years ago The Last Jedi came out, this was a big improvement. I liked it a lot more. I want to see it again just because I just want to see it again. I liked how I felt afterwards. I didn't feel like, oh my God, that was awful. I enjoyed myself. It was fun. I laughed. I cried. All the nostalgia and like, yes, it was heavy nostalgia, but I felt overall it was a fitting end to this franchise, or at least this saga that we've all loved. And like I said, for however long you've been alive, that you've been around for the Star Wars, whether you started liking Star Wars 3 years ago, 7 years ago, you liked it since it came out 42 years ago, we're all still fans. We also still need to remember the good things that we love about Star Wars and not let one maybe movie that we did not like ruin everything. Because there were still good parts in it. And I felt like the good outweighed the bad. Because, like, can I nitpick a lot? Yeah, you can nitpick in every single movie and every single thing. But at the end of the day, the kind of lost hope I had since The Last Jedi, I felt like a lot of it was restored with this. And that I'm gonna buy episode 9. So, that's kind of my condensed version. Because I know my other one was longer. Hopefully this was a lot shorter. And if you could not tell, I liked it. So, hopefully you guys all saw Rise of Skywalker by now. It's been a week. What were your thoughts? Comment them below. As always, make sure you like, share, and subscribe. I put out a new video every week. And be kind and respectful, you guys, please. There's no need to name call me or anyone else in the comments or to be rude. If you don't like it, you can say it in a nice way. There's a way to say you don't like something without being incredibly rude and insensitive and just hateful. We don't need more of that in the world. Don't contribute to it. It's almost the end of Do Good, Donate December, where either try to do something good or donate money or your time or goods to animal shelters, homeless shelters, anything. We need to create more positivity in this world than all the hate that is spread here. And whether it's something small or not, like I said, I've donated money and some, like I've given like a homeless man a sweater for his dog, given him money, and other people I've seen with animals money as well. You just try to do a little bit good here and there because you have no idea that the ripple effect. So be mindful when we're speaking between one another, you guys. Remember, guys, they win by making us feel like we're alone. And you're not alone. I loved it. Not afraid to say it. May the Force be with you.